National Desk, America's News Now. Bank run backlash. Former CEOs of banks that collapsed explained their failures, taking the banking crisis to Capitol Hill as regulators push to restore confidence in depositors before it's too late. Doomsday default. Congressional leaders returning to the White House for talks with another reminder of the debt limit deadline.
You really have to have this all done by the end of the week. You know how these things go. They blow up, they blow up, they come down. But this is something so big, so important.
The clock ticking with little agreement between GOP leaders and the president. Durham conclusion. A bombshell report handing the former president a victory in a years-long Russia collusion probe. The failures by the DOJ drawing sharp criticism this morning. New Mexico massacre. As we come on the air, victims fighting for their lives after a tragic shooting. The investigation unfolding as we learn new information about the chaotic scene. Live from the nation's capital, this is the National Desk, America's News Now. I'm Jan Jeffcoat. It's Tuesday, May 16th, and we do start this morning together following several economic developments that could impact your money. First, right now, top congressional leaders are preparing to meet with President Biden to try and find some common ground on raising the debt limit. Also, the banking crisis taking center stage on Capitol Hill today, following three of the four largest U.S. bank failures of all time. And we want to get right to Kale Thompson at the live desk as regulators try to ease concerns over contagion. Good morning to you, Kale.
Good morning, Jan. The heads of Silicon Valley and Signature Banks due in the hot seat 1 hour from now at 10 o'clock Eastern. They will be testifying to Senator on the Banking, Housing, and Urban Affairs Committee, the first of several hearings we anticipate this week centered around this year's bank collapses. It will also be the first time we hear from Silicon Valley's former CEO. He's expected to apologize to bank employees, clients, and shareholders and blame the bank's failure on a combination of rate hikes and rumors that spread quickly online, leading customers to withdraw $142 billion over 2 days. That was 80% of the bank's deposits gone in 48 hours. On the other side of the Capitol this morning, bank regulators will testify to the House Financial Services Committee. The vice chair of the Federal Reserve is expected to emphasize that overall, banks remain safe. He'll share the lessons learned from the recent bank failures and discuss plans to overhaul bank rules to hold smaller banks more accountable in the future. We also expect to hear regulators say today that they'll be more open-minded about allowing banks to merge in the future. That follows remarks from Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen over the weekend, indicating some smaller banks may look to merge given the current financial environment.
Developments overnight on debt ceiling negotiations between the president and House Speaker Kevin McCarthy. The National Desk, Satra Elnishar, joins us from Capitol Hill with where things stand before the leaders meet this afternoon. What are you hearing, Atra?
Yeah, Jan, President Biden, Vice President Harris, Speaker McCarthy, and other congressional leaders will meet at 3 p.m. Eastern for their second in-person meeting this month. And as we've reported, staff-level meetings have been going on in the background, but with little sign of tangible progress, at least publicly. Now, yesterday, the Speaker said there's been no progress that he can see, which he calls concerning given the timeline. Speaking of, Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen did update the Congress, confirming June 1st remains the soonest the U.S. could default, but she notes that could move days or weeks later. Now, as is the case for all leaders involved, House, Senate, White House, any concessions or compromises made run the risk of alienating their members whose votes they need. The president's suggestion, for instance, that he'd agree to stricter work requirements for some aid programs has already triggered criticism from his party, particularly progressives. So we expect an update immediately from both sides, just like we saw last time, as soon as they finish the meeting this afternoon. And one thing, of course, we'll be watching for, Jan, is any sign from the president about potentially postponing his trip to Japan to stay here to get this deal done. I'm Atra Elnishar for the National Desk, America's News Now.
Atra, thanks so much. The House passed a bill requiring law enforcement to let people know when their private data has been obtained from tech companies within 5 days. An FBI audit revealed 8,000 searches of Americans' communications in 2021 and 2022, despite having no warrant or justification under their own rules. New details on the criminal investigation into President Biden's son. The IRS has reportedly removed the investigative team looking into Hunter Biden's tax fraud allegations. The New York Post claims the removal was directed by the Justice Department and was retaliation against the whistleblower who contacted Congress to allege a cover-up in the case. Lawyers for the whistleblower sent congressional leaders a letter which states in part, removing the experienced investigators who have worked this case for years and are now the subject matter experts is exactly the sort of issue our client intended to blow the whistle on to begin with. The IRS has admitted that it targets too many black taxpayers for audits. The commissioner for the government's collection agency is studying whether to cut the number of audits for taxpayers who claim the earned income tax credit. This comes after a study found the IRS audit rate for blacks taxpayers was 4.7% higher than for others. Giving you a live look over Capitol Hill, where there will be a classified all-senator briefing focused on Iran today. It involves high-ranking officials of all defense agencies and comes as the administration pushes to strengthen defense in the Persian Gulf. Over the past 2 weeks, Iran has seized at least two commercial ships there. Meantime, the Iran nuclear deal is dead, and the White House says Iran is still working to supply weapons to Russia for its war in Ukraine.
The deepening of this cooperation is a threat and a danger to not just Ukraine. It's a threat and a danger to Russia's neighbors, Iran's neighbors, and the international community broadly.
Officials say Russia has used most of the 400 drones it already purchased from Iran and needs more artillery and ammunition for tanks. The American dream of buying a new car is now out of reach for millions of Americans. The National Desk's Angela Brown joins us right now. And Angela, we know that the average monthly payment for a new car has skyrocketed because of those rising interest rates.
That is one major factor, Jan. And when you look at the numbers, it was surprising to me. The monthly average car note is over $700. That is close to rent in some states. But so many drivers are now holding on to their cars they already have because they don't want to pay that money. The big number this morning, nearly 122 million cars on the road right now are more than a dozen years old. And that trend may not be slowing down. The S&P predicting that the number of older cars will keep growing for the next 5 years. And here is one major reason why. The price of a new car surged to nearly $48,000 in April. A nearly 24% increase compared to 3 years ago. Experts say if you still plan on buying new, though, try a shorter loan.
One thing that is very anti-trend is look at shorter loan terms, because generally the shorter the loan term, the lower the interest rate. A lot of automakers are subsidizing shorter loan terms.
But it's not just new cars. Used cars are up over 40% since the pandemic, hitting 29,000. Average loans, monthly loan for used cars around 560. The Washington Post reporting automakers are selling fewer new vehicles in the U.S., but their 2022 revenue was still up $15 billion than in 2019, partly because cars are more expensive. And Jan, you just said you're one of those folks.
I am one of those folks that has a car that's 12 years old. And it still runs great. So why give it up?
And no car payment.
That's right.
Which
no
is great.
Right. Angela, thank you so much. We appreciate you for that report. New this morning, a super PAC has been launched for a possible presidential run from former Vice President Mike Pence. Last week, he said he would make a decision on running by the end of June. The latest poll from CBS and YouGov had Pence polling at just 5% among GOP primary voters. Ahead this morning, making way for migrants, former acting commissioner of Customs and Border Protection Mark Morgan tells us how the surge is impacting public schools.
And police working through the night trying to figure out the motive in the nation's latest mass shooting. What we are learning about the teenage gunman's actions and the message from the city's police chief coming up. First, we are following breaking news here at the Live Desk. The Secret Service says it is investigating a car crash early this morning at one of the security gates at the White House. Nobody was hurt in this, and there's no mention if agents think it was an accident or intentional, but they do say they are looking into whether alcohol was involved. We'll have any updates right here at the Live Desk. We're back in 90 seconds.
My A1C stayed here. It needed to be here.
Ruby's A1C is down with rebelsis.
My A1C wasn't at goal. Now I'm down with rebelsis.
Mom's A1C is down with rebelsis.
Study, once daily Rybelsus significantly lowered A1C better than a leading branded pill. Rybelsus isn't for people with type 1 diabetes. Don't take Rybelsus if you or your family ever had medullary thyroid cancer or have multiple endocrine neoplasia syndrome type 2 or if allergic to it. Stop Rybelsus and get medical help right away if you get a lump or swelling in your neck, severe stomach pain, or an allergic reaction. Serious side effects may include pancreatitis. Tell your provider about vision problems or changes. Taking Rybelsus with a sulfonylurea or insulin increases low blood sugar risk. Side effects like nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea may lead to dehydration, which may worsen kidney problems.
Need to get your A1C down?
Ask your healthcare provider about Rybelsus today.
Take a summer vacation with Seinfeld.
I proclaim this the summer of George!
Beat the heat.
Jane's topless. Yo, yo, ma.
Take the plunge.
Do women know about shrinkage?
Like when a man goes swimming afterward?
It shrinks?
It's a Seinfeld summer.
Like a frightened turtle.
It's Seinfeld, weeknights at 11 and 11:30 on KDOC-TV, Los Angeles.
As we come on the air this morning, police in Farmington, New Mexico are trying to piece together the motive in the country's latest mass shooting. The police chief there calling it one of the most horrific days his community has ever faced. New photos this morning show the small town in northwest New Mexico holding a prayer vigil overnight for the victims in Monday's rampage. Police say the attack appears to have been purely random. There were no schools, no churches, and no specific individuals targeted. 9 people were shot in all. 3 people were killed, 6 more injured, including 2 police officers. The first reports of gunshots came in just before 11 o'clock Monday morning, 10:57 there in Farmington. Officers were on the scene within minutes. The shooter, identified as an 18-year-old man with at least 3 guns. He was ultimately shot and killed by police.
I don't even know what to say on an event like this. How do you address it? I have my deepest condolences to the family of the deceased. I'm unbelievably proud of responding officers with the threat that they faced.
The chief there saying that during the course of this event, the shooter roamed throughout the neighborhood up to a quarter of a mile and shot indiscriminately at least 6 houses and 3 cars. Farmington police are planning another news conference coming up this afternoon at 2 o'clock in New Mexico. That would be 4 o'clock Eastern. We may get victim names and more on the suspect's possible motive at that time. We'll be working to bring you updates here at the Live Desk and online at thenationaldesk.com.
Parents in New York frantic and furious after learning their child's school gymnasium would be used to house migrants. Joining us this morning is former acting commissioner of Customs and Border Protection and visiting fellow at FAIR and the Heritage Foundation, Mark Morgan. Welcome back to the National Desk. Good morning to you, Mark. Parents in the Big Apple threatening right now to pull their kids out of school after seeing these cots set up in the gyms as an emergency intake site. What are you hearing about this?
First of all, I think the parents are right. I think their outrage is well placed. What is misplaced is this administration's priorities. Literally, think about this. Thousands of illegal aliens, many of them adult males, are coming to New York, and their answer is to put them into the gymnasium, into the school where our kids go. And the reality is, we know virtually nothing about these individuals that have illegally entered our country. And the parents are outraged, as they should be, that I mean, the kids are, oh, nothing to see here. We'll just keep the kids in the classroom. I mean, it's absurd, Jan. It's ridiculous. And let's also talk about New York is also the place where they've actually kicked homeless veterans out of the hotel to make room right for illegal aliens. I mean, literally, this is where we're at within our parties. This is what you get when you have an administration whose priorities put the interests of the entire world ahead of our own country. And this is the result of when you have policies that are driven by ideology and the quest for political power rather than what's in the best interest of America. Literally, you're putting single adult males that we know nothing about in schools and kicking veterans out for illegal aliens.
In the meantime, the White House is calling it sabotage after a federal judge blocked the Biden administration's policy to release migrants on parole from these holding facilities. Tell us about the legal implications here and what this means for border agents who have to deal with this now.
Yeah, Jan, look, this is another example of it's laughable sabotage. This administration inherited the most secure border in our lifetime. And day one, through hundreds of executive orders, they systematically dismantled the network of tools and authorities we had. Whether it was the Safe Third Country with all three Northern Triangle countries, the Remain in Mexico program, the building the wall system, and they basically neutered ICE's ability to remove criminal illegal aliens from our streets. And now, when they try to continue to cover up the chaos that they've created by unlawfully using mass parole, when they're stopped from violating the law once again, they claim they're the victims. Basically, what this will do is, it just in this one area, Jan, it will prevent Secretary Mayorkas from actually directing the men and women of law enforcement on the front lines from violating the law. But make no mistake, this is simply putting the finger in a large, large hole in the dike.
Yeah, speaking of Secretary Mayorkas, he says there's been a 50% drop in the number of encounters versus what we saw a week before Title 42 ended. Here's what he had to say about whether we had peaked with the surge. Take a listen, Mark.
So it's too early to say whether the surge has peaked.
It is too early, but the numbers that we have experienced over the past 2 days are markedly down over what they were prior to the end of Title 42.
Markedly down. Mark, what's your thoughts on this?
Yeah, look, I know it's early, but I got to do this, Jan. Look, first of all, do you notice that this indignant, like, smug smirk on his face when he was talking? Let's be honest here. Think about this. Here's my analogy. This would be equivalent to an arsonist starting an intentional fire of your home and watching your home burn to the ground. And then as the fire starts to move over to your detached garage, the same arsonist jumps in and stops the garage from burning and then says, look, I'm a hero. I stopped your detached garage from burning down. Now, you're back to the same spot you were, and your house is totally destroyed. That's literally what the secretary was saying. Think about this. In the days leading up to Title 42, we saw a spike in illegal apprehensions go up by 50%. A few days later, they went down by 50%, and he's claiming victory. Jan, we're literally in the same catastrophic open border issue that we were a few days before Title 42. We're still at 6,000 illegal entries every single day. That, by any definition, is still a catastrophic, unmitigated, self-inflicted crisis on our borders, and this man is claiming victory.
And House Republicans trying to do something about it. They did pass the Secure the Border Act, which was opposed by every Democrat, as well as two Republicans, Mark. So tell us about this legislation and why these two Republicans voted against it.
Look, Jan, I think it's very important that you talked about where the vote split. This is very important. We're talking about our nation's border security, our ability to safeguard our safety and our nation's national security. And what we saw was a vote right down party lines. As you said, not a single Democrat voted for this. That tells you that border security has become a political issue, a political talking point. They're playing political games with lives of Americans and lives of migrants. And I'm glad you mentioned the Republicans, because I hope Americans remember this. I hope the citizens of Kentucky remember that Representative Massey out of Kentucky was only one of two Republicans that didn't vote for the strongest border security bill we've ever seen. Look, I don't think the bill goes strong enough, but Jan, hands down, it's the strongest border security bill we've ever seen. It would codify a strategy we used under the Trump administration of deterrence, consequence, and putting integrity back in the system. You would see a reduction of illegal immigration and fraudulent claims, and you would see an increase in our border security.
Former Acting Commissioner of Customs and Border Protection and visiting fellow at FAIR and the Heritage Foundation, Mark Morgan, thanks for joining us. Great to see you, as always.
You bet. Thanks for having me, Jan.
Ahead this morning, staffers assaulted, dropped charges that kept a suspect on the streets, now accused of attacking the offices of a lawmaker.
And breaking here at the live desk, the latest retail sales report just out this morning, what it says out about our economy, coming up here in 90 seconds.
Alex, run!
Nice dress.
Was I dreaming?
No, you're in California.
He's obsessive.
And don't get so balcony, it's perfectly safe.
Wasn't perfectly safe for her.
He's compulsive.
Monk, what are you doing?
Straightening up.
Look, we're trying to intimidate this woman.
And he's cleaning up the city.
So how's he doing?
He's cleaning up San Francisco single-handedly.
One crime at a time.
If you're guilty, would you please raise your hand?
I told you, he's...
Get obsessed with Monk.
Saturdays at 2 and 3 on KDOC-TV Los Angeles.
All right, breaking here at the Live Desk. We just got our hands on retail sales for the last month. Economists were hoping to see a rebound after two straight months of declines, and they did get that, though not as much as hope. Check it out here. Retail sales rose 0.4% in April compared to the 0.8% that was predicted. Either way, a sign that shoppers increased their shopping, helped by a still solid jobs market and easing inflation. Wall Street is in the process of digesting this news, along with the latest earnings report just out this morning from Home Depot. Big earnings miss for Home Depot this morning. They are also forecasting even weaker sales in the months ahead. Because of that, the Dow, S&P, and NASDAQ all trending lower this morning. The Dow currently down by more than 100 points with 9 minutes until the opening bell this morning.
Just released figures show American household debt has surpassed $17 trillion as families across the country struggle with red-hot inflation. The National Desk's Dee Dee Gatton spoke with financial experts to break down the details.
Total household debt has reached a new high, more than $17 trillion in the first quarter of this year, according to the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. Financial experts tell me they're not surprised Americans increase debt across nearly all categories.
This number should not be shocking, especially since interest rates have almost doubled over the last year.
A just released Federal Reserve Bank of New York report shows an increase in total household debt to more than $17 trillion in the first quarter of this year. The data shows balances are $2.9 trillion higher than at the end of 2019.
In order to pay for my schooling, I didn't want to get super behind with loans, so I just started doing anything I could on the side.
The report shows Americans increased debt across nearly all categories, including for student loans, auto loans, mortgages, and home equity lines of credit.
In my professional opinion, I like home equity loans versus home equity lines of credit. A loan, you are locking in an interest rate a certain period of time, and you're paying down principal and interest at a very fast rate. On a home equity line of credit, you pay revolving interest every month.
As the Federal Reserve continues to raise interest rates, financial advisor Danielle Luke says debt is costing Americans more each month as some turn to credit cards. The data for the first quarter shows credit card balances were flat, but Luke believes personal debt is going to be on the rise.
What we've seen so far with credit card debt is with COVID, you saw some people take their stimulus checks and actually pay down debt. People weren't able to spend, so they either home improvements or they paid down debt. So we haven't seen debt, really personal debt in the form of credit cards, rise over the couple of years because of the impact of COVID. I think, Dee Dee, we're going to start to see personal debt rise again because of interest rates.
Luke tells me if you're looking for a place to put your money, consider a high-yield savings account. The interest you make could help offset some of the inflation. And if you don't need the money for a year or so, she says a CD could be another option. Reporting for the National Desk, I'm Dee Dee Gatton.
Two congressional staff members are recovering after being attacked by a man with a baseball bat. They were working yesterday in Congressman Jerry Connolly's office in Northern Virginia. Police say 49-year-old Swan Cotran Pham used a metal baseball bat to attack a senior aide and an intern. Last year, the suspect was charged with assaulting a police officer, but those charges were later dropped.
It's quite frankly scary that someone can just walk up to an office holding a baseball bat and just start swinging at innocent victims.
Pham has been charged with aggravated malicious wounding. Both staffers are out of the hospital. Tennessee Governor Bill Lee signed off on additional protections to shield the gun industry from lawsuits. The provisions were included in a bill lawmakers passed after the deadly shooting at a Christian elementary school back in March. The bill aims to protect small firearms businesses in the state, and those provisions will go into effect on July 1st. Ahead in our next half hour, the bombshell report. We're going to break down the 320-page report revealing the FBI's aggressive role in probing false ties between Russia and the former president. Also, Addicted America, a powerful animal tranquilizer now linked to overdose deaths, the emerging threat facing the U.S. We're going to have those stories plus a look at your top headlines coming up next. First, though, here's a look at America's news and weather now where you live.
I'm meteorologist Charlie Lopresti with Look at the Northeast. One more mild day is on tap for today before things start to change on Wednesday. You'll notice a big cool down in the Northeast Wednesday. And the reason for that, we have a cold front moving through. We'll bring with us some showers this evening and tonight. Then the wind picks up out of the Northwest. Cooler air will start to move in out of Canada for Wednesday. Hey, look at 70s and 80s this afternoon. As we go into Wednesday, though, we're having a hard time getting out of the 50s. There could be a frost in many areas Wednesday night into Thursday morning.
I'm meteorologist Jonathan Myers, and here's a look at the Mid-Atlantic region. Looks like a cloudier day for most on Tuesday, especially from southern Maryland southbound. There could be some on and off rain as well as our next weather maker moves on through. The extreme northern portions of the area may get away dry with some of the warmer temperatures closer to 80, but everybody else a little bit more moist, mid to upper 70s, Baltimore near 80 degrees, Roanoke and Richmond. That's the scene here.
I'm meteorologist Vitas Reed. Here's a look at your southeast forecast highs for the day. Looking at 86 in Raleigh, 84 in Charleston, a warm one in Macon at 88 degrees, Nashville 85, 90 Birmingham, 90 Jacksonville, Tampa about 89 degrees. Looking at a day starting off with sun and clouds, but you can see a line of showers and thunderstorms developing over near Knoxville, north of Atlanta, over towards Birmingham and Huntsville. It looks like you'll probably get some thunderstorm activity moving through your area. A little bit heavier downpours through the evening, rush hour, so be prepared for that.
Good Tuesday morning, everyone. I'm meteorologist Andrew Buckmichael taking a look at your weather story across the Midwest. We do have some scattered showers and storms across the southern part of the Ohio Valley, but the rest of the plains here looking pretty good for the day today. Let's continue into your Wednesday. Got a few showers and storms starting to move in the Dakotas and far western Nebraska there on Wednesday, while most of us are dealing with plenty of sunshine, and that rain continues to drift its way east on Thursday. Still a lot of sun across the Ohio Valley and a little cooler for Bismarck.
Good morning. I'm meteorologist Alex Garcia. Here's a look at your regional weather. We're starting off a little warm and humid down along the Texas coast and Louisiana coast. A little further back, one up to the north, a little cooler. Temperatures into the 50s. A weak cold front will make its way southward today, kicking off a few little showers, bringing clouds, keeping temperatures just a little bit below the normal in some areas. Otherwise, look for highs in the 70s and into the 80s today. I'm meteorologist Alex Garcia. That's a look at your regional weather.
Well, hi there and good Tuesday morning to everybody. I'm meteorologist Shannon O'Donnell. The heat still bearing down, especially over the desert southwest. Back to the triple digits today out of Phoenix and not far behind a 95 out of Vegas. Look at the cool temps around coastal California, just 60s there, courtesy of the fog there. The May gray, as they call it, around San Francisco and Los Angeles. You can see the scattered thunderstorms that will bubble up across the west later today. And that's the scene from here.
Exterior, Los Angeles, a busy day at the Walk of Fame.
Oh, you got another idea?
Cut to the sights, the sounds, the dream sequence. I love the Academy Museum, but I've got a scene to write. Now that's a great scene. Nailed it.
Hi, it's me again. Listen to this. Medicare Part C plans with extra benefits like getting money added back to your Social Security check every month may now be available to you in your zip code. Make sure you're not missing out. It's simple. One, call the number on your screen. Two, they'll look up your zip code and see if you're eligible. Three, they'll check for plans with extra benefits like prescriptions, dental coverage, and the benefit that adds money back to your Social Security check every single month. Call now.
I called to get everything I deserve.
I called to check my zip code for a plan with the benefit that adds money back to my Social Security check.
I called to check my zip code.
Check your zip code. It could be dynamite. Call now.
Call 1-800-420-3300. That's 1-800-420-3300 now.
We want you to shush people.
I'm trying to use the phone.
Impractical Jokers on KDOC-TV Los Angeles.
Desk, America's News Now.
Now on the national desk, America's News Now, stranger than fiction. The FBI revealed to have spied on the Trump campaign over false claims made into martyrs. The new report revealing more countries crushing people's right to worship their religion of choice. And worse than fentanyl, the new drug flooding the streets, where it's coming from, and the damage it can do. We could also soon hear testimony from Special Counsel John Durham about the discredited Russia collusion investigation. He's been invited to speak before the House Judiciary Committee after releasing his final report about the faulty government probe, finding it was all based on fiction. Durham gave his 320-page report to Attorney General Merrick Garland on Friday, who reviewed it and publicly released it yesterday with no redactions. Durham's report found investigators did not possess any evidence of collusion when they started investigating, that FBI personnel repeatedly disregarded their own standards when seeking FISA warrants to spy on the Trump campaign, and that the FBI and Justice Department failed to uphold strict fidelity to the law. The report also found the Clinton campaign created the narrative and that Hillary Clinton approved a proposal by a foreign policy advisor to investigate Donald Trump in an effort to divert attention away from the scrutiny she received by sending classified emails over a private computer server. Hillary Clinton's Twitter account still has the false claim that the Trump organization had a covert server linked to a Russian bank. That claim was made by her advisor, then Jake Sullivan, who was currently President Biden's national security advisor. The report found that then President Obama and Vice President Biden knew about Clinton's plan because they were briefed about it in person by then CIA Director John Brennan in August of 2016.
You can't interfere in a presidential election without consequences. At least you couldn't. You used to not be able to in America. And that's what happened here. That's what this report shows, that one political party, the Democrats, tried to use the FBI to rig a presidential election and just about got away with it. They succeeded in getting the FBI to intervene. They succeeded in getting the FBI to lie to a court to get wiretaps. They succeeded in getting a presidential campaign, Donald Trump's campaign, spied on.
The FBI acknowledged the Durham report, issuing a statement that they took corrective action and that if these reforms had been in place in 2016, these missteps could have been prevented. Former President Trump saying the report proves the investigation was a hoax, posting, "Congratulations to John Durham on a report that is being praised for its quality, importance, and professionalism." The New York Times and Washington Post won Pulitzer Prizes for reporting on those debunked claims. Iowa Senator Chuck Grassley tweeting, "There should be tremendous outrage on the part of journalists who were lied to by FBI. The Durham report conclusion is FBI exhibited political bias. I'd like to see big time media admit hoodwinked." And Colorado Representative Lauren Boebert stated, "The FBI corruption revealed by the Durham report is unforgivable. The FBI must engage in serious structural reform, including firing deep state operatives."
Here at the Live Desk, a new report this morning shows where countries are cracking down on people based on their religious beliefs. That report is released by the White House, the Biden administration, saying that freedom of religion is vital to stable and secure societies. That said, countries specifically outlined in this report as major offenders of freedom of religion include Russia, India, China, and Saudi Arabia. Secretary of State Antony Blinken sharing both the positives and the negatives in this report.
Over the past year,
we've seen real progress in some parts of the world on expanding religious freedom as people demanded their rights. Civil society groups pushed for change, and governments listened. Unfortunately, the report also documents the continuation, and in some instances the rise, of very troubling trends. Governments in many parts of the world continue to target religious minorities using a host of methods, including torture, beatings, unlawful surveillance, and so-called re-education camps.
The U.S. report estimates that Beijing jailed 10,000 people or more in 2022 because of their spiritual beliefs, an accusation that China denies. The White House reiterating that freedom of religion is a bedrock principle in America and says it will continue to advocate for those where religious rights are under attack.
This morning, more proof Russia is relying on Iran for weapons in its war in Ukraine. The National Desk, Satra Al-Nashar, is live with the details of a new potential weapons deal. Satra, good morning.
Hey, Jan. Yeah, according to the White House, Russia's working on getting more lethal attack drones from Iran after going through the 400 or so it's already received from the country. Now, the National Security Council's John Kirby is telling reporters Russia has used most of those drones to target critical Ukrainian infrastructure, calling Iran Russia's top military backer that has been directly enabling its war. Kirby said the partnership is also enabling Iran's own agenda in the Middle East. So in response, the White House, in partnership with allies and the United Nations, is considering new sanctions on both Iran and Russia, and also ways to tighten export controls to make sure that Western parts don't get into Iran to be used to make these drones. Now, keep in mind, the U.S. and its allies are also keeping a close eye on Russia's reliance on North Korea for weapons and China for economic and political support. All of this set to be top of mind for President Biden and G7 leaders during their summit in Japan later this week. I'm Atra El-Nashar for the National Desk, America's News Now.
Thank you, Atra. The DEA calling a new drug the deadliest drug threat our country has ever faced. Animal tranquilizers mixed with fentanyl are flooding the streets. The National Desk's Angela Brown joins us now in this Addicted America report. And Angela, this drug is also coming across the border.
Yes, it is, Jan. The DEA says cartels are using chemicals sourced from China, helping to create this poison, killing Americans. The street name here is Trank. The White House declaring it an emerging threat, bipartisan lawmakers introducing legislation for research, but it's already here.
What Trank does to the body sounds straight out of a horror film.
The drug all around is absolutely terrifying. It also destroys the tissue at the injection site.
Xylazine, street name Trank, is being mixed with fentanyl, described as a flesh-eating zombie drug because it leaves scars, lesions, and kills. Dr. Jenkins from Cedarville University describes the internal damage.
The other thing that can happen is you can cause severe liver and kidney injury from the use of this product.
The DEA warning of a sharp increase in trafficking. The White House labeling it an emerging threat. Narcotics prosecutors applauding that move.
I'm glad there was the emergency declaration pertaining to Trank, because that will allow us, will allow the government to actually track it better.
Already, the numbers are mind-blowing. The DEA mapping out the increase in xylazine-positive overdose deaths by region from 2020 to 2021. The South, over 1,000%. West, 750. Midwest, 516. Northeast, over 100%. And look at this. Last year, the DEA says roughly 23% of fentanyl powder and 7% of fentanyl pills seized contain xylazine.
The concerning thing is the cartels that are mixing these substances into these products, and you have individuals taking these things not knowing they're there. And that is something they didn't sign up for necessarily.
And what makes Trank even more deadly and also dangerous is that doctors are warning that Narcan, a drug that reverses overdoses, does not work on Trank.
All right, Angela, thank you. Ahead this morning, economic outlook, former White House economic advisor Steve Moore on whether lawmakers will address the national debt and how long inflation could last. Also, not a toy, one family's shocking discovery in a Happy Meal and what McDonald's is saying about it.
Who doesn't love a good nickname?
There he is, my little ice angel.
My talented, delicious little boy.
Scrumptious little snuggle monster.
Are you done?
I love you, Boopy. Hi, Schmoopy.
Hey, Boopy. Boopy.
Boopy.
Boopy.
What?
Schmoopy, Doopy, Boopy, Soopy.
You need help.
Watch the comedy about the most scrumptious, delicious, totally rad family of snuggle monsters.
Nom, 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 nom.
You know them by their full name.
The Goldbergs, weekdays at 4 and 4:30 on KDOC-TV Los Angeles.
Allergies just try to stop us being the greatest versions of ourselves. Allegra lasts up to 6 times longer than Benadryl, so trees, you won't take us down.
Allegra starts working 2 times faster than Claritin, so dust, you won't wipe us out.
And unlike Zyrtec, Allegra won't make us drowsy. So fur, you won't phase us. When allergies attack, take Allegra before your symptoms take over you. Live
your
greatness.
Type 2 diabetes?
Discover the Ozempic Trizone. My Ozempic Trizone, I lowered my A1C, CV risk, and lost some weight.
In studies, the majority of people reached an A1C under 7 and maintained it. Ozempic lowers the risk of major cardiovascular events, such as stroke, heart attack, or death, in adults also with known heart disease. And you may lose weight. Adults lost up to 14 pounds. Ozempic isn't for people with type 1 diabetes. Don't share needles or pens or reuse needles. Don't take Ozempic if you or your family ever had medullary thyroid cancer or have multiple endocrineoplasia syndrome type 2 or if allergic to it. Stop Ozempic and get medical help right away if you get a lump or swelling in your neck, severe stomach pain, or an allergic reaction. Serious side effects may include pancreatitis. Gallbladder problems may occur. Tell your provider about vision problems or changes. Taking Ozempic with the sulfonylurea or insulin may increase low blood sugar risk. Side effects like nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea may lead to dehydration, which may worsen kidney problems.
Ask your healthcare provider about the Ozempic Trizone.
You may pay as little as $25.
We are just hours away from Republican lawmakers in North Carolina voting to override the Democratic governor's veto of a controversial bill banning nearly all abortions in the state after 12 weeks of pregnancy. Republicans have a very slim supermajority in North Carolina. If they lose just one vote, that veto will be allowed to stand. From North Carolina to a live look over downtown Lincoln, Nebraska, just down the street from the state capitol this morning, lawmakers in Nebraska will debate a bill tonight that would combine both a ban on abortion at 12 weeks and a ban on gender-affirming care for minors. Regarding the abortion part of this bill, lawmakers in Nebraska are considering calculating the last date for an abortion from a woman's last period, not from fertilization, which abortion rights supporters say essentially cuts a 12-week ban down to 10 weeks. If lawmakers failed to pass the bill, abortion in Nebraska would remain legal up to 20 weeks. The other aspect of this bill would ban gender transition surgeries and puberty blockers for those 18 and younger. Debate is scheduled from 7 o'clock to 9 o'clock tonight at the state capitol in Lincoln, and it is expected to be contentious.
Debt ceiling talks hit a critical crossroads today as President Biden meets with congressional leaders. Plus, inflation begins to slow and unemployment starts to rise. Joining us right now, former White House economic advisor Steve Moore. Good morning to you, Steve. I know you keep saying no lawmaker would allow the country to go into default, but you know they're cutting it pretty close, especially given they still have to take any compromise through the whole legislative process to get something done. So what are you hearing on the Hill? What can we expect?
Well, Jan, negotiations have started. You know, the president's position was that he was not going to negotiate on the debt ceiling. But now that the Republicans have gotten a debt ceiling bill through the House and the Democrats can't seem to get anything through the Senate, this is going to have to be resolved through negotiations between Speaker Kevin McCarthy and the president. And so, you know, they're in the first couple of rounds of this boxing match. So that is will be an important meeting today. I don't believe that the June 1st deadline the president and the Treasury has been talking about is really a hard deadline. And I think that I'll just want to let your viewers know, I think the chance of any kind of default on the debt is pretty close to zero, although everybody's watching this very closely. And you're going to have the president give on some of his positions. You know, the Republicans want do not want funding for those 87,000 new IRS agents. They want to claw back some of the unspent COVID money. And so there's a lot to be negotiated here.
Well, that's the point here, I think, is that time is running out, regardless if it's June 1st or maybe July or August.
Right.
We're still up against the clock right now. Do you think they're just going to kick the can down the road?
They'll reach an agreement. And they'll reach an agreement and probably will be sometime in a matter of weeks. I don't think they'll probably make the June 1st deadline, but I want to make sure that your viewers understand the government, and I've lived through these many times
right.
in the past.
You have.
So the government can jigger the, take some money out of some of the retirement funds and use that money until the debt ceiling is raised. So I don't think that there's virtually any possibility of a default on the debt. That would be, really bad for the American economy.
Disastrous.
But it's also true, Jan. I mean, look, we now have a $31 trillion debt. And, my position is, and I think a lot of Republicans, is we can't just keep borrowing $2 trillion a year and think that story is going to have a happy ending.
And as you mentioned, there's going to be some creative accounting going on behind the scenes. So
they're very good at that.
Yes, they are. Inflation, meantime, in April hit at the lowest rate in 2 years at 4.9%.
Yes.
Steve, we saw the cost of eggs finally going down, along with some other grocery essentials. So will this trend continue?
I think you summarized it very well, Jan. So you've got the inflation is coming down, no question about it. We had 9% inflation last summer. Now it's down to 5%. Remember, Jan, we want to get that to 2%. That's the target. That's the target that the Fed has set for an appropriate inflation number. But you're also seeing a weakening of the economy. And you're right. You're seeing that unemployment rate creep up. And you know why, Jan? Some of those, rate increases. Remember, we've had, 9 or 10 rate increases by the Fed. Those are starting to increase borrowing costs. They're affecting the housing market because mortgages are going up. So it's a very precarious time for the U.S. economy. And by the way, this does circle back to those debt negotiation talks, because I believe as an economist, one of the most important things we can do to help keep this economy going is to bring down this enormous debt and stop borrowing $2 trillion a year.
Yeah. And what are these unemployment numbers telling us? Has the Fed achieved this soft landing? What are some of the key economic factors you're keeping a close eye on right now?
I look at the labor force participation rate. Are we getting workers back into the labor force? Remember, it's been now 3.5 years since COVID. A lot of people still haven't returned. Millions of people haven't returned to the job. So we got to get people back on the job. I am also looking at the GDP numbers. For the last 5 quarters, the U.S. GDP has only grown at about 1%. We've got to be growing much faster than that. We need a robust recovery. But I'm not buying into, Jan, this idea that recession is inflation. I know recession is inevitable. I know a lot of economists are saying that. I think we can get through this without a recession.
I like your positivity here. It's very encouraging. Former White House economic advisor Steve Moore, great to see you. Have a great week.
Have a great day. Take care.
Thank you. Ahead this morning, caught on camera, what we learned about a restaurant after a rat was spotted in the chandelier above diners.
And the eye-opening report revealing what may be linked to a higher chance of developing Parkinson's, the military base at the center of this study, and the chemical that could be in your water. Next in 90 seconds.
I'm still tasting what's next, even with higher stroke risk due to AFib not caused by a heart valve problem. So if there's a better treatment than warfarin, I'm hungry for that. Eliquis. Eliquis reduces stroke risk better than warfarin and has less major bleeding than warfarin. Eliquis has both.
Don't stop taking Eliquis without talking to your doctor, as this may increase your risk of stroke. Eliquis can cause serious and, in rare cases, fatal bleeding. Don't take Eliquis if you have an artificial heart valve or abnormal bleeding. While taking, you may bruise more easily or take longer for bleeding to stop. Get help right away for unexpected bleeding or unusual bruising. It may increase your bleeding risk if you take certain medicines. Tell your doctor about all planned medical or dental procedures.
The number one cardiologist prescribed blood thinner. Ask your doctor about Eliquis.
A lot of new dry eye patients in my office tell me about their frequent dry eyes, which may point to dry eye disease. Millions of Americans were estimated to have it. They also tell me they've tried artificial tears again and again, but the relief is temporary. Xiidra can provide lasting relief. Xiidra treats the signs and symptoms of dry eye disease.
Don't use if allergic to Xiidra. Common side effects include eye irritation, discomfort or blurred vision when applied, and unusual taste sensation.
Why wait? Ask your eye doctor about a 90-day prescription for Xiidra today.
Of U.S. Marine vets may be at higher risk of developing Parkinson's if they were stationed at Camp Lejeune in North Carolina. That is the finding of a new study just published in the medical journal Neurology. It finds Marines at the camp in the 70s and 80s are 70% more likely to develop Parkinson's compared to service members at other military bases in the U.S. Researchers believe the higher percentage of cases is linked to a chemical called trichloroethylene, or TCE, widely used as an industrial cleaner. Researchers looked at health records of some 340,000 troops at Camp Lejeune between 1975 and 1985 when water was known to be contaminated with TCE. Scientists aren't 100% certain what causes Parkinson's. They know age is a factor, and some believe exposure to chemicals like TCE is also driving a growing number of cases. That's important because the Agency for Toxic Substances and Diseases says up to 18% of U.S. drinking water sources tested by the EPA have come back positive for some level of TCE contamination.
This is the National Desk, America's News Now. Our team of nearly 4,000 local journalists bringing you the headlines from coast to coast. From a Happy Meal shocking an Ohio family to a toddler saved at a New York festival, we are taking the pulse of America. And we start with an unwanted guest at a California restaurant.
We were ordering, and when all of a sudden I saw that big red dot on the chandelier.
Martin Santa Rosa posted this on Facebook saying, "My family and I went to eat at the Four Seasons restaurant in Clovis, and this is what we saw."
That's not on the menu, huh? One of the waitresses right there, and I called her and I told her, "Hey, look at that." And she said, "Oh." And she said, "Oh." And she saw my recording. She said, "Oh, now the whole world is going to know." The food has been always good at that place. You know, it was just the fact that, we saw that rat right there.
A representative from the county sent an email back stating the Four Seasons Chinese restaurant is current with their fees and permit. The Fresno County Department of Public Health, Environmental Health team does not need to perform an inspection at this time.
I don't think we're going to go back to that place anymore.
Went up to the checkout window, got the box Happy Meal and the drink, and I passed it to her. This one says from the back seat, "Mommy, there's some really weird toys in my Happy Meal."
It was a lighter, but I have no idea what the other thing was.
The other thing was apparently a vape device. This is a picture Rosemary took a few minutes after she says she bought the Happy Meal.
I was shocked. And then I panicked initially because did she put it in her mouth?
Westchester police could not find any laws broken.
That vape and that lighter, they look like a toy. My daughter could have very easily put that in her mouth and she could have started a fire. And I could have spent the weekend in the emergency room instead of enjoying Mother's Day.
McDonald's corporate apologized for any inconvenience. The franchisee said, "We are in the process of investigating these claims."
McDonald's. Really, any restaurant needs to make sure that doesn't happen again, because she could have not been fine.
At Highland Park, a perfect day for the Waddle family to make their annual trip to the Lilac Festival.
It's a happy family. We're having a great day, and in 1 second, your day changes, and it's drastic and it's fast.
The family sat down to have lunch, and their toddler, Sam, began to act sleepy.
So we thought, "Oh man, it's been a busy day for him. He's probably going to fall asleep on us while he's eating lunch." And then his head tilted again, and then the second time it tilted, his eyes rolled back in his head, and he completely started to convulse. His whole body started shaking.
Sam had never had a seizure before. His mom, Alicia, ran for help.
So I just picked him up immediately and ran down the hill screaming, "My son is having a seizure." And then all of these people came running towards me immediately.
Among them, a pediatric nurse and another mom who knew exactly what to do because her son has seizures.
That woman standing right there told me, "Get him on his side, make sure he, his mouth is open, doing all of these things, showing me what to do with his body to keep him safe." I didn't know that if she wasn't there. She helped me keep my son safe the entire time he was having a seizure. Sam is healthy and he's happy and he's our playful little boy because they were able to come and help us in our time of need.
A Gerber infant formula under voluntary recall for possible contamination reached retailers in 8 states. The products include 12.4-ounce cans of Good Start Soothe Pro powdered infant formula that you can see here on your screen. It was manufactured between January 2nd and 18th and could contain a harmful bacteria that could be deadly. So if you live in any of the states listed here, double check your pantry. And if you have the formula, they say you should throw it out immediately.
He is a convicted terrorist responsible for killing 8 people, and he will learn his sentence in just a few hours today. Why his life will be spared, coming up in 90 seconds.
I have type 2 diabetes, but I manage it well. It's a little pill with a big story to tell. I take once daily, Jardiance. At each day's start, as time went on, it was easy to see. I'm lowering my A1C.
Jardiance works 24/7 in your body to flush out some sugar. And for adults with type 2 diabetes and known heart disease, Jardiance can lower the risk of cardiovascular death, too. Jardiance may cause serious side effects, including ketoacidosis that may be fatal, dehydration that can lead to sudden worsening of kidney function, and genital yeast or urinary tract infections. A rare life-threatening bacterial infection in the skin of the perineum could occur. Stop taking Jardiance and call your doctor right away if you have symptoms of this infection, ketoacidosis, or an allergic reaction. And don't take it if you're on dialysis. Taking Jardiance with a sulfonylurea or insulin may cause low blood sugar.
Whatever the crime.
You never come to work thinking you're gonna see something like that.
Whatever the motive.
If he couldn't have her, no one was gonna have her.
Whatever it takes, answers to mysteries will be revealed.
Question is, who's gonna benefit by these two deaths?
I remember falling to the floor. He was finally caught.
On Dateline.
Weeknights at 8 and 9 on KDOC-TV Los Angeles.
It's out live to New York City this morning, where a judge will sentence a convicted terrorist today to the rest of his life in prison. This is Saifulu Saipov, convicted of killing 8 people on a bike path in New York City in 2017 in the worst attack there since 9/11. Saipov was found guilty of driving a rented U-Haul truck into cyclists and pedestrians. Prosecutors say he was inspired by his support for ISIS. He was eligible for the death penalty in this case, but a jury spared him in March when they failed to unanimously agree on his punishment. That means Saipov will be sentenced today to life in prison. His attorneys say he is expected to serve that sentence in Colorado and will spend at least 22 hours a day in solitary confinement. Here's news and weather where you live.
I'm meteorologist Charlie Lopresti with Look at the Northeast. One more mild day is on tap for today before things start to change on Wednesday. You'll notice a big cool down in the Northeast Wednesday. And the reason for that, we have a cold front moving through. We'll bring with us some showers this evening and tonight. Then the wind picks up out of the northwest. Cooler air will start to move in out of Canada for Wednesday. Hey, look at 70s and 80s this afternoon. As we go into Wednesday, though, we're having a hard time getting out of the 50s. There could be a frost in many areas Wednesday night into Thursday morning.
I'm meteorologist Jonathan Myers, and here's a look at the Mid-Atlantic region. Looks like a cloudier day for most on Tuesday, especially from southern Maryland southbound. There could be some on and off rain as well as our next weather maker moves on through. The extreme northern portions of the area may get away dry with some of the warmer temperatures closer to 80, but everybody else a little bit more moist, mid to upper 70s, Baltimore near 80 degrees, Roanoke and Richmond. That's the scene here.
I'm meteorologist Vitas Reed. Here's a look at your southeast forecast highs for the day. Looking at 86 in Raleigh, 84 in Charleston, a warm one in Macon at 88 degrees, Nashville 85, 90 Birmingham, 90 Jacksonville, Tampa about 89 degrees. Looking at a day starting off with sun and clouds, but you can see a line of showers and thunderstorms developing over near Knoxville, north of Atlanta, over towards Birmingham and Huntsville. It looks like you'll probably get some thunderstorm activity moving through your area. A little bit heavier downpours through the evening, rush hour, so be prepared for that.
Good Tuesday morning, everyone. I'm meteorologist Andrew Buckmichael. Taking a look at your weather story across the Midwest. We do have some scattered showers and storms across the southern part of the Ohio Valley, but the rest of the plains here looking pretty good for the day today. Let's continue into your Wednesday. Got a few showers and storms starting to move in the Dakotas and far western Nebraska there on Wednesday, while most of us are dealing with plenty of sunshine, and that rain continues to drift its way east on Thursday. Still a lot of sun across the Ohio Valley and a little cooler for Bismarck.
Good morning, I'm meteorologist Alex Garcia. Here's a look at your regional weather. We're starting off a little warm and humid down along the Texas coast and Louisiana coast. A little further back, one up to the north, a little cooler. Temperatures into the 50s. A weak cold front will make its way southward today, kicking off a few little showers, bringing clouds, keeping temperatures just a little bit below the normal in some areas. Otherwise, look for highs in the 70s and into the 80s today. I'm meteorologist Alex Garcia. That's a look at your regional weather.
Well, hi there and good Tuesday morning to everybody. I'm meteorologist Shannon O'Donnell. The heat still bearing down, especially over the desert southwest. Back to the triple digits today out of Phoenix and not far behind a 95 out of Vegas. Look at the cool temps around coastal California, just 60s there, courtesy of the fog there. The May gray, as they call it, around San Francisco and Los Angeles. You can see the scattered thunderstorms that will bubble up across the west later today. And that's the scene from here.
When you fall and can't get help,
help,
you will lie on the floor for hours or days in constant terrible anguish, which often results in a tragic outcome. But with Life Alert, one touch of a button can get you help fast.
Don't worry, help is on the way.
With any of Life Alert's three emergency systems, help can be summoned immediately, whether at home,
I've fallen and I can't get up,
in the bathroom,
I've fallen in the shower,
or on the go,
help, I'm in the park and I can't get up.
And batteries never need charging. Life Alert saves a life every 11 minutes.
For a free Life Alert brochure, call 1-800-658-8114. That's 1-800-658-8114. Call now, 1-800-658-8114.
He was our business manager. He's supposed to pay taxes.
There is one asset the government has allowed you to retain.
The kids.
Question.
Yes, your cologne is too strong.
You are being super dramatic.
Yeah! You're doing it, son!
What's this about?
I was just hugging my kids.
Why?
Schitt's Creek, weeknights at 12:30 and 1 a.m. on KDOC-TV Los Angeles.